you saying you stayed at home and you were a, forgive me, I don't know what a pot washer is. Can you tell me what that job is that you had?
Yeah, so I used to work at a local hotel.
Yeah.
And then every time someone would eat, they would give me the plate, obviously, to bring it into the kitchen from the waiter, and I would be the one washing it. Wash it, put it into this big industrial machine, shut it, lift it up, wipe it, clean it down, and then put it away.
So while you were living at home, going to uni, essentially washing dishes, you had this massive dream of creating this massive clothing label, which later on was valued at £1 billion.
Basically, yeah. 30 or 60 grand in 10 minutes. Bearing in mind, we hadn't made anything close to that within a week.
How come you left at such a poignant moment?
It wasn't intentional for me to just get up and leave my company that I'd just started, do you know what I mean? Why would I? I mean,
yeah.
We're about to make loads of money, why am I just gonna leave, do you know what I mean? You're buying into the brand, why'd you buy Givenchy, Louis Vuitton? You're buying the brand, right? Same with any type of brand, including in activewear. Initially, it starts with the product at the end of the day. If you can't sell your product, then you're never gonna get anywhere. And then once you get to a certain point, you can start to build out your brand. The best, as you just mentioned, the best thing for anyone to do is have everything black and white before you start, because as soon as you start to make money, things change and people think they're entitled to something else that they have already agreed to. That's happened numerous times.
You don't really want to disclose the amount that you got from leaving Gymshark, whether it's 100 million or 200 million. A lot of people would see that figure and just say, I can put my feet up. Like, I actually do not have to do much in life now. So what has made you still have that drive to say, do you know what? I'm gonna make other businesses successful and I'm gonna work really hard even though I'm sitting on between 100 and 200 million.
I've always had the drive to continue to keep doing things. I mean, I don't believe that anyone should just retire. I think it's not good for the mind.
So Lewis, thanks for coming.
No worries.
Before we get into it, I hope you brought me some goodies. Even if it's just some leggings.
I'll have to ask Ali in the back.
Yeah.
But I'm sure we can sort something out with, with a new company.
It's just unacceptable. We've got Gymshark founder. We've got, is it Able?
Able, yeah.
You've got a clothing line called Able, which is similar to, not similar to Gymshark, but fitness.
And same age demographic.
Oh, is it?
Mm-hmm.
And you've got Manny Devoir, fashion as well.
Yeah.
And no goodies. Not acceptable, is it? But yeah, let's go back prior to Gymshark and talk about you wanting to sell supplements before you actually got into clothing, because I found that really interesting. And not just that you were selling supplements, but you also managed to manipulate Google in a way. I want to hear how you did that, because you can't really do that now.
No, exactly. So what's called Gymshark now, we were actually called Gymshark Supplements. This is like 2011.
Yeah.
We started as a supplement company because, you know, you go to the gym. Back then, no one really cared what they wore. All they wanted to do was just be hench. How big can you get? And it was protein, Jack3D supplement, Optimum Nutrition, Serious Mass. Like, how big can you get? And we thought, okay, so there's an opportunity for us now to create a protein brand, because back then there weren't really many. I think it was like maybe bulk powders, My Protein maybe back then, and there weren't very other one anymore. So we thought, okay, let's make a brand, Gymshark Supplements. And we didn't know how to make the supplements. So what we did is we went on bulk powders, bought loads of different, you know, beta-alanine, caffeine, anything else, and basically mixed it all up. But obviously that's not how you mix supplements, right? You know, they're done in industrial shakers and so on. So we were mixing things up and we were shaking them around and we were giving them to our friends and they weren't sitting right with them. So they would, even with too much caffeine or, you know, they weren't mixing properly.
Well, they're sitting on the toilet for ages.
Yeah, was, you know, so they weren't even training, or we were training for 6 hours. So we thought, no, this can't be right. So what we ended up doing was pulling back our own supplements, but we went on something called Tropicana Fitness. We listed all of their products on our website and basically made collections within Shopify, which got us to the top of Google. And then from there, people would search like Optimum Nutrition, Serious Mass, and then it would come up top and they would just buy straight away. So you would order from us, and we would order from them to you. So we weren't ever holding any stock. We would just dropship.
So you essentially were subsidiaries?
We were the middleman.
You were the middleman?
Yeah.
And that was a lot easier because then you didn't have to go through compliance. You didn't have to go through what the ingredients were. And then when you were doing that prior to getting into clothing, Were you making a decent amount of money then?
No, we were making minimal, £3-4 per supplement, something in the region of that. So, but obviously when you're not holding in stock and it doesn't really matter what you're making because you're not taking any risk. Mm-hmm. So we were happy.
And then when did you decide to get into clothing? Because I know that one of your iconic tops were like the stringer vests that, I'll be honest, I find them cringy.
Right.
I grew up in a gym with my dad being a bodybuilder and it was normal for me to see it, but I just find it cringy because literally, for people that don't know what a stringer vest is, it's a vest that just covers your nipples, doesn't it?
Yeah, basically.
And it tries to create this illusion that you've got massive pecs, doesn't it?
Yeah. It's basically a way of going into the gym, not wearing anything, but still wearing something. So yeah. The actual fabric starts below your nipples, really. You've got a tiny little string of fabric above the nipples so you can see your whole physique. So yeah. When you're pumped and you're walking around the gym, everyone could see what they're working with, you know what I mean?
And then did you actually make them yourself?
Yeah, so what we did originally is we bought from America because at the time, this is like 2010-11, it wasn't like it was now. You couldn't kind of just buy off from America and get it next day, two days, 3 days. It was you buy from America for $25, you pay $80 to $100 shipping, and then you get it shipped over, which is going to take 25 to 30 days. Mm-hmm. So within that bottleneck, we realized there's a lot of people over here in Europe that want them. Let's get them in bulk from America and bring them over to the UK and start distributing them. So that's what we did. Started off with drop shipping, then we ordered loads, and then we actually met up this guy from the UK, went to his house, saw how he was printing vests, and then we kind of went home, went on YouTube, and just learned how he was printing them, which was screen printing. We ended up buying a screen printer ourselves, and then screen printing our own logo, which was that bodybuilding tensing shark that you've probably seen. Mm-hmm. That was our logo at the time. We printed that on the stringer vests.
And then around that time, you were like 17, weren't you?
17 at the time, yeah.
Yeah. So then how did you manage to get the funding or the money to buy the clothing, the printer, or did you just use your own money?
So yeah, it was formed up of the uni grant that we got for going to uni.
Yeah.
We stayed at home, both of us. He went to Aston, I went to Worcester. So we both stayed at home. We used some of the grant and we used the profits from the dropshipping side of things to put back in, to invest in, you know, I think the screen printer was £1,000, which was a lot of money. And then we had to boil the fabric. And we recently just figured out, you know, okay, we can't keep printing to order because we were printing. What we did, we've got loads of vests, stuck them up. So we'd have like 50 black vests, but we'd have like 10 prints. Every time you ordered, we would print to order. And obviously that was taking the piss, basically. We couldn't scale up like that.
Yeah.
So we went on Alibaba, found a supplier, ordered from China, already made vests, our best sellers, and brought them over.
And the interesting thing about you and Ben, because you knew, but he was your friend before you started Gymshark, is you literally were doing everything yourself. And I don't think people that start clothing labels now actually understand how much goes into it, because you saying you stayed at home and you were forgive me, I don't know what a pot washer is. Can you tell me what that job is that you had?
Yeah, so I used to work at a local hotel,
yeah,
and then every time someone would eat, they would give me the plate, obviously, to bring it into the kitchen from the waiter, and I would be the one washing it. You'd wash it, put it into this big industrial machine, shut it, lift it up, wipe it, clean it down, and then put it away.
So while you were living at home, going to uni, essentially washing dishes, you had this massive dream of creating this massive clothing label, which later on was valued at £1 billion.
Basically, yeah. At the time, it was take it step by step. I mean, our end goal wasn't the money. It was just to let's bring everyone together through health and fitness, through our clothing.
Yeah. And how did you decide? Because I'm sure Ben wasn't your only friend. I'm sure you had loads of friends at uni. How did you decide to come together? Because a thing that we don't discuss enough is friendships, but useful friendships that can create partnerships to propel two people or a group of friends to success. So were there any other friends that said, well, we want in, or why didn't you ask me? How was it just you and Ben?
So it wasn't just me and Ben. So we had other businesses just before Gymshark, and there was like multiple of us, me, my friend, Reese, and you got Reese Obar, who was playing football at the time, but you had Reese Edgerton, who I'm now in Able Group with. So there was a small community of us. Mm-hmm. Back then it was different because now you can go online and you can find people that are like-minded really easily over forums, apps, you know, through whatever means you want. Back then, obviously, it was whoever you're around. Mm-hmm. And we kind of just gelled. We met early in school, we were like 12, and then when we were in double ICT, when we were like 16, 17, that's when we really gelled and we started to build things together. We started with like a fitness app, mm-hmm. which was one or two in the UK, which was Ben built the app, I did all the content. We had an online marketing platform, similar to how Unilad and Lab Barbell are today, mm-hmm, you know, mm-hmm. using social media to push to a website, to put ads on it, to make money. We did that originally back in 2011 and we were making a lot of money, but we kept getting banned on AdSense all the time because we were putting like underneath the you can go next button, we were putting the ads, and obviously you can't because people were misclicking on the ads and we were making quite a fair bit of money and they kept banning us. Had we not got banned at the point, we probably wouldn't have continued with Gymshark because we were making so little money originally.
Okay, so when did you start to see real money? So in terms of how many years, because when I was reading up on you even investing in having a stall at Body Expo, and at the time, your clothing brand, Gymshark, wasn't hardly making anything, but you knew you had to pay between £8,000 and £10,000 to be at Body Expo. So a lot of people would have thought to themselves, oh, sod this, I'm not going to do that because we're not making the money. So how did you know we're going to risk this even though we've got to find the money from somewhere?
Because we'd already been there. I'd already been there since like, what, 2010, 11? I think it started in 2010 or maybe even 9. So I'd been there a few years before. I knew the footfall and the traffic of what it entailed, mm-hmm. and the power. If we could get influencers to it, which we might get onto, we could bring influencers over from the US and bring them to Body Power, how yeah. much it would explode. No one else was doing that. It was USNs, your Optimum Nutrition. They were all just boring companies that had yeah. athletes that had just won competitions, but they didn't have any following. Yeah, you might look good, but you don't have any following. Mm. So we saw the power with influencers, brought them over. But when we actually got the stand and kind of like agreed to pay the money, it was mm-hmm. a year behind. So we were kind of betting on ourselves and what we believed in would work. And that was kind of it in terms of the actual game plan.
Did you and Ben find that your mindset was completely different to everyone else around you? So I know that you've said before, when everyone else was partying and drinking, we were like taking what bits of money we had, you washing dishes, Ben doing whatever he was doing in terms of a job on the side of uni. And I know I read that you used to alternate, didn't you? So yeah. Ben would do part of the business at nighttime after work in uni, and then you'd swap around. And yeah. like, when were you sleeping? When were you partying? When were you shagging girls? Like, when were you doing all the fun stuff that young people do?
We weren't. Truth is, we weren't. You know, you had your odd holiday a year with your friends, but realistically, we were running this company every single day, 24 hours a day. If something needed printing, we would print it. We would go to the gym and we would just print t-shirts, vests. We kept skipping uni. The reason I dropped out of uni, because I knew I was never going to pass it because I wasn't even turning up. I was too busy printing t-shirts for people that were ordering them.
What were you studying at uni?
Business management and accountancy, but that wasn't because I wanted to do it. It's because I thought I should do that. Mm. That might lead me onto a decent job, just in case all else failed.
And what was Ben studying?
Similar, I think. Business management, I think, or something along those lines.
So in terms of going back to a partnership, did you have certain strengths that he didn't have, and did he have certain strengths that you didn't have, and that's why it made sense?
Absolutely, yeah. So I was more like outgoing, like crazy with the ideas and stuff like that. And then he was like, he knew how to make websites early on. This was like early on before not many people did. So together we gelled really well. This is the idea, let's put it together. This is the idea, let's put it together. And we were, yeah, that's how it worked.
And then how did you go from, you know, trying to make it make money from it making, let's say, its first million? When did you really see like, oh shit, this is happening, it's making sense?
I would say the first ever Body Power, because we aimed to launch something called the Lux Tracksuit at Body Power event. Yeah. So we got all our athletes that we'd just brought over from America
yeah.
that people were never going to see apart from at our event. And we stuck them all in this Lux Tracksuit, but we didn't actually sell the tracksuit.
Is that the tapered tracksuit?
That's the one, yeah.
So I should blame you for all of the Essex look and the overly skinny tracksuit?
maybe. But our plan wasn't to sell it there. It was yeah. just to keep everyone in it, get loads of pictures and gain a massive hype. Like, you can't get this tracksuit until we launch it. Everyone's in it, everyone wants it. So we put loads of pictures all over the internet. Everyone's like, okay, so all these guys look really good. They're all in our tracksuits. Where the hell can I get it? Maybe, I think it was like a month later, we launched a tracksuit and we made something like 30 or 60 grand in 10 minutes. Bearing in mind, we hadn't made anything close to that within a week.
So it literally went from...
Yeah, within just because of that launch, we were selling it and we hadn't even got it in stock yet. It was on the air and we were mm-hmm. still selling it.
Yeah.
So, you know, it looks good on the outside, but behind closed doors, we were running around like rats.
So would you say, even though there was some creativity with Gymshark in terms of the clothing, the tapered look, the stringer vest, so on and so forth, would you attribute the success of the brand more to you being ahead of the game with getting influencers involved and your marketing strategy? Because let's say, for example, like now or in the last 2 years, and don't take offence to this,
yeah, go on.
But in terms of the seamless wear that women wear with Gymshark, I've tried it on, it is good. However, it's not impossible to find similar outfits that are seamless and that fit almost just as good and look good. I understand that a lot of people, they buy into the name, which is amazing. But would you say what really catapults a fitness brand like Gymshark is the strategy that you guys had?
Yeah, absolutely. So most things are cut and sew, cotton. The only thing that separates them is a brand. That's it. You're buying into the brand. Why'd you buy Givenchy, Louis Vuitton? You're buying the brand, right? Same with any type of brand, including in activewear. Initially, it starts with the product at the end of the day. If you can't sell your product, then you're never going to get anywhere. And then once you get to a certain point, you can start to build out your brand. Us bringing over athletes and seeing that early on wasn't something we intended to do in terms of we never thought it was going to go where it went to in the future. Mm-hmm. It was something that we were interested in at the time. So anything that we were interested in at the time, we kind of jumped on it. And it, you know, now it's easy to say, you know, that was a really smart move. But back then it wasn't that smart in terms of it cost us loads of money to get the guys over. And we didn't really know where it was going to take us. We just believed they were getting 30,000-40,000 views on YouTube back in 2013, which is probably equivalent to millions now. Mm. We knew that there's no way that this is not going to work. If we put our clothing on these guys and they come and vlog it, how the hell is anyone not going to purchase? They only get one chance to see them. I mean, 60% of Americans probably don't even leave America. Most don't have passports because they can go into each state,
yeah.
No issues. So we thought if we can bring them over here and everyone from the UK or the surrounding areas like Europe want to come and just visit them for the first time, maybe in their life, and they all did. So it was just like perfect synergy that we didn't assume was going to be so big now.
So when we look at Gymshark as a brand and how you've managed to go from strength to strength, how come you left at such a poignant moment?
Yeah, so in 2016, I resigned as a director, selling some of my shares, but not all of my shares. Obviously, it's a hard situation for me to talk about because of the legalities as well behind it. But it wasn't intentional for me to just get up and leave my company that I just started. Do you know what I mean? Why would I? I mean,
yeah.
We're about to make loads of money. Why am I just going to leave? Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So without going too far into it, it's hard for me. I left as a shareholder in 2020. So October 2016 is when I resigned as a director. And I think it's September 2020 is when I completely sold all my shares and joined Able Group.
Okay, and there's always different figures flying around about how much you managed to get from that. Like some say 150 million, some say 100, some say 200 million. Mm. How much did you obtain from that deal?
We'll leave that to speculation because it doesn't really matter. Like, I mean, at the end of the day, what does it matter how much money someone's got? It kind of doesn't, you know, it doesn't change. My work ethic is still exactly the same, whether I have £1 or £1 billion. That doesn't change because I don't wear nothing flashy. Same clothes every day.
I'd agree that it doesn't matter the specific amount, but I wouldn't say that money doesn't matter for the simple fact that one of the reasons why Gymshark is so revered is because it was valued at $1 billion. Even you yourself said that you managed to sell the tracksuit, the tapered tracksuit, in 30 minutes.
Yeah.
And made 60,000. So I think money does matter, but I'd understand why you may not want to divulge the specific amount. But for me, I just think it's so important. When you look at a brand, it's important to look at the key figures in it. And I've always seen Ben and I've always loved Gymshark. How come I've never seen as much in terms of you discussing Gymshark and your name is not flying around as much as Ben? Why do you think that is? Without going too much into...
Yeah, of course. Obviously, you're right in what you're saying in regards to metrics, because everyone uses money as a metric
for
someone's success, because it's what public companies put out. It's what everyone, it shows growth really easily. But it's not, again, the be all and end all.
Of course not,
But like you say, in regards to Gymshark, I mean, at the end of the day, I'm not involved in the company now, so they're not going to mention me, because it looks better to have one founder that's majority shareholder of the company and put him at the forefront. Originally I thought it was all to do with greed, but since he went on the most recent podcast with Stephen and he mentioned that I left in 2014, which is completely not true. Check on company's house. As I said, I resigned as a director in 2016, so now it's clearly about credit. And I think as things go on now, you'll probably see them mention me even less, because I now have a competitor brand.
But this is why I wanted to talk to you, because whenever I respect a company, I like to know its journey. And if it didn't start with one person, it's important we know who the founders were. And this is why I found it interesting, because again, I think no man is an island. Yeah, you do have people that single-handedly start a business, but oftentimes it does start with two and three in a small community, which propel it. And as you even said, it was a joint effort in the initial days. So I'm glad that you've come and spoken to us about it, even though I understand that some of the topics is hard. And I think your success, even after Gymshark, is a testament, because you're doing phenomenally well now with your other projects.
Trying.
Even when I think it's amazing that you've gone into now property development as well, which you wanted to do anyway. So how did you manage to go from supplements, fitness app, string of vest tops, and then decide to flip properties and houses and stuff?
Property always interests me, because, you know, money on a screen is like money on a screen, but money in property is bricks and mortar, and you can physically see it, and it's a different type of energy. Like, if I said to you, like, we've had 60,000 visitors on a website, you'd be like, that doesn't mean nothing. But if I put 60,000 people in front of you, that's different. That's the same as a property. Mm-hmm. £1 million into a business, £1 million into a property is a complete different concept. So I've always been interested in it. And at the end of the day, if I build a house, it's going to outlive me. It's going to be here forever. So I always really wanted to get involved in it. So I ended up building houses from scratch, taking old commercial buildings and switching them into apartments through a residential loophole. And
what's the residential loophole?
Well, it's not really a loophole. It's just you can do like a B2 conversion. So like you don't have to do too much planning to then switch it.
Okay.
It's not really a loophole.
Okay. So when you say you were building these properties from scratch, how did you manage to get a good group of people? Because I know a lot goes into getting contractors, and I work in the industry, and it's some of the hardest to get really good tradesmen. Do you have a trade yourself for you to have an eye for who's good and who isn't?
No, but I know the process of what you need to do at the end of the day. I want to build this house. When I first went into property development, I didn't have a clue. But all I did was threw myself in the deep end, did loads of research on Zoopla, Rightmove, okay, what's this plot of land? If I get loads of costs, okay, what's the plastering cost? What's going to be the brickwork cost? And you can kind of break it down, what profit you're going to be left at the end to decide what type of plot you're going to buy. So I'd buy a plot and then I'd literally just get someone in, okay, so we need to do this with the architect, he'll design everything. Okay, so I need to then do the brickwork. So let's get 10 different quotes on bricklayers, and let's go with the cheapest or not just the cheapest, the most reliable. Because you know what it's like. You try and ring someone or you tell them to turn up on a certain time, they don't even respect your time or turn up, which is annoying.
Yeah.
And then you have to get someone else in. So we do that, and then you get to the next stage, put the roof on, contact loads of roofers. So literally just step by step. But once you've done it once and you've used certain contractors once, your next project is pretty easy. But what I will say about building is every project is as hard as any. One house is the same as building 10 houses. You still get the exact same problems in one house as you do with 10. So you might as well go bigger than smaller.
Than smaller, because you get the same.
Yeah.
So how many have you built to date? Do you know the number?
So built from scratch, probably about 16 houses. Converted about 3 or 4 different apartment blocks. Yeah. And things like that. So.
And do you partner anyone, or do you use all of your own capital?
All of my own capital.
And did you use the capital that you made from Gymshark to propel your property development business?
A little bit, but also other investments from the stock market and, not so much crypto back then, but yeah, just the savings and stuff.
Okay, and where do you see that going? Do you want to... Because the thing at the moment is we've got a huge housing crisis. So do you think that the government should partner people like you to be able in certain areas to assist them with building more? How quickly?
I think I think the easiest way to answer that is the government just need to lay up the planning process. There's a lot of houses in planning, but there's a lot of land that people want to build on, but the planning process is terrible. They don't want to give you planning for the land. I think that would solve a hell of a lot of problems. And you know, building takes like no educational skill to get into. Anyone can kind of get into it, no problem, and they can make really good money. And I think more people need to look to that as a job and start to get into it, because at this moment in time with building, the supply for labour is really low, but the demand is really high, because no one wants to, you know, go and dig a hole, or no one wants to go plaster a wall, and they can sit behind their keyboard at home and reply to people. They don't want to do that. But the money over that side is unbelievable.
It's crazy.
Yeah. So the demand is there. We just need more supply, and we also just need the governments just to help us with, you know, just the planning process, because there's a lot of people ready to build.
But then both industries that you are in, they kind of counteract each other, because on one hand you have someone who can literally start a label, a clothing label, or go on Instagram and use Instagram for their body or whatever else, and blow, essentially. And then on the other hand, you're saying, you know, we need people to want to dig a hole or get into the trades. So how would you suggest encouraging people that trades make sense and you can make loads from it?
It's really hard without perspective. So like most people that leave school, they're not really shown perspective or shown how much you can make. I believe that we should, you know, some of the last lessons probably in school should be about actually how much you're making from each sector, how much you can make. Like, all right, so we've got, you know, 24 hours in a day. You're going to be up 9 hours. How much money can you make in that time? So let's, you know, educate people a little bit more so then they can then decide. I didn't know what money was involved with building, you know, dig a hole here, you're going to get £3. But that's not the truth. You can make a hell of a lot of money. Bricklayers, we're paying them £250 a day for a bricklayer. Electricians, again, £200 a day.
And it's more down here in London.
Yeah, it's even more in London. So you can make so much money from the building. It's just that people don't understand or have any perspective. I think it's really cool to want to go into those e-commerce jobs, which is absolutely fine. But, you know, look at the other side too.
You've gone back into clothing now as well. Even though you've still got property development, you've gone back into clothing. Is that, would you say that's because it's a passion of yours? Because even though you said you don't really want to disclose the amount that you got from leaving Gymshark, whether it's 100 million or 200 million, a lot of people would see that figure and just say, I can put my feet up. Like, I actually do not have to do much in life now. So what has made you still have that drive to say, do you know what? I'm going to make other businesses successful and I'm going to work really hard, even though I'm sitting on between 100 and 200 million.
I've always had the drive to continue to keep doing things. I mean, I don't believe that anyone should just retire. I think it's not good for the mind. So for me, it was a really easy step to get back into e-commerce. And I wasn't done. Like, the end of my journey wasn't finished. I could have sat in Gymshark with the rest of my 20% stake, floated the company for billions of pounds. Billions of pounds, not just the billion we
if
got
you
valued stay, at.
If you stayed,
stayed in
kept
and made
your
loads
shares.
More money, but I want to do other things. And obviously, when you're involved in companies, you know, at the end of the day, you might own the company, but you still got to answer to the board of directors. And, you know, you can't make a competitor brand. You can't go into this. You have to put your time into one thing. So for me to step away and come back in, I could do that on my own terms. Do you know what I mean? Which was perfect. So I'm now in a company called Able Group, which is some other friends from school. Again, they've got big e-commerce backgrounds. We've got a fashion clothing brand within that called Because of Alice, and another activewear brand called Be Able, which again, we're gonna rival Gymshark, and we're gonna make this the next £1 billion company or wherever we take it.
So that's your aim, to be the main competitor to Gymshark?
Not within Able, we're gonna be bigger. But
why Able, do you think you're gonna be bigger?
Because I think that we've got the skills, there's three of us in it now, and we've also got the drive. I mean, there's this fire inside me that you can't just get any, you can't just wake up in the morning and start a company. That comes from being hurt, do you know what I mean? So I've got this new fire inside me now that's going to propel this to exponential levels. I mean, we're 7 years behind as an activewear company, but trust me, we won't be seven years behind come 2-3 years down the line, no way. It's one of the fastest growing companies in the UK. It's already been valued at 50 million. Again, I use metrics.
Money does matter.
within 3 years. I say that because it's an easy way for people to understand how fast something's growing.
Yeah.
So.
No, but let's be honest. Fair enough. If a lot of people that watch successful people, I think they feel, I don't want to say offended, but they feel a bit offended when people say money doesn't matter, because it clearly does.
Of course.
Do you know what I mean?
You wouldn't do anything if it was free, right?
So you would not do anything if it was free. And again, you would just walk away from Gymshark and say, I don't need the money. Why should you do that? So I think it's important that it should not be the be end and the end all, but money definitely matters, but it shouldn't dictate your movements in life. I'd agree with that. So going back again to the importance of, let's say, compatibility of partnerships, because what sort of advice would you give when you want to get into a partnership, and what things should you avoid? And this is just speaking generically. Give you some time to think. I think it's really difficult to actually go into business with friends or with family, for the simple fact that if someone's been your friend for a long time, or someone's obviously your family, as soon as you become professional and corporate with that person and say, listen, I want all of the contracts, I want you to, they get a bit offended because they're like, come on, I've known you for years, we don't need to do a contract. Like, and I don't like that. I don't want to have to deal with that. This is not me scratching your back for free. This is now friendships there. I want to make this an official business. So if later on down the line there's issues, legal issues, everything is in black and white. So what would your advice be when it comes to partnering? Because even though you said you were hurt and burnt with Gymshark, you've gone back into partnership with Reese Barbara.
I was already in partnership with Reese Barbara. Okay. Reese Edgerton, yeah, which is another friend. So there's two Reeses. Reese Edgerton,
yeah,
which is the founder of Able. And then you got Reese Barbara, who's the founder of with me, with Manny Edouard.
Yeah, so
two Reeses.
So my point is, even though you've had bad experience or hurt or whatever you want to call it, you've still seen the value in working with people. So what would your advice be?
There's two sides to the story, because you can put contracts in place, but then it all depends on who you're working with. If the people are always out to get you, then they're going to get you no matter what the contract says. Do you know what I'm saying? So like, it all depends. I would always say the best, as you just mentioned, the best thing for anyone to do is have everything black and white before you start, because as soon as you start to make money, things change and people think they're entitled to something else that they have already agreed to. That's happened numerous times in different companies, but I've never had an issue with any of my companies other than the one. So, you know, it's a toss-up. But I would always say, as I said, black and white, have it all laid out ready.
Have it all laid out.
Just in case anything comes on in the future.
And I've seen you say things, because you're quite passionate about the next generation, which I love. And one of the things that stuck out to me is stay at home. And both you and Ben stayed at home. Yeah. And my mother's from Pakistan, and in Asian communities, we tend to stay at home until we can buy property.
Yeah.
And that's why you see a lot of Asians have a lot of property, because that's what the norm is. But I think when it comes to like my Caribbean side and a lot of my white friends or whatever, they're so desperate to leave home. But then you're spending money in rent. So how do you convey that message of, do not be embarrassed, just stay at home?
Well, it's almost like it's the cool thing to do, right? Okay, let's move out as soon as I can. You know, some people have to move out, which if you have to move out, then you've got no other option to stay at home, then that's absolutely fine. I mean, you've done your best and, you know, continue to save and stuff, because for most people, it's not the monthly payments that hurt them, it's the deposit for the house. And it's hard to, once you're in a rented accommodation, to then save up the deposit to then move out into the house, because you've got loads of different fees and stuff. So just stay at home as long as you physically can and just continue to save. Then when you can get, you know, a deposit for a flat, a house, whatever it might be, then do so.
And what advice would you give to people that are wanting to start now, similar to what you've done with clothing labels? Because I personally think it's very saturated. I think when I see t-shirts, they all look the same, the colors all look the same, the fit all looks the same. What are you doing different with Able that's going to propel it as a business?
We're gonna build the community, and that's gonna be the difference. We're gonna build a big community of like-minded people around the world, North America, Europe, Asia, wherever it is, all around the world. I'm going to bring everyone together through health and fitness, because at the end of the day, there's nothing like a routine. It can pull you out of any hole, a gym routine especially. You know, you the thing with health and fitness is you don't know you need it until you need it. So everyone always needs to stay in shape no matter what, and everyone's always going to need gym clothing. And people always want new friends. So it's such a community within the gym space, which is why we're going to be different. In regards to like other brands and other clothing, everything is the same realistically, and that's why the people behind the brand, especially for the first couple of years, they're the only people that can save a brand. So like, when we're investing in a company through Able Group, I don't care about the numbers. I care about the people because I'm investing in you. If you're within 3 years of a startup, mm-hmm. you could come to me and say, I'm going to make 200K, 300K or 300 million in 2 years' time. But truth is, I have to believe you, and that's the only thing I'm interested in. So it all depends on the people.
So are you going to be using a lot of influencers like you have before?
Of course, yeah.
Is that the key, do you think, in terms of trying to start?
It's a great way because through ads, let's say, you can't bring that emotion across. Mm. Just like if, you know, me and you did a podcast and it was just text on the screen, there's no emotion. Whereas on camera, there's emotion. So, and in person, there's emotion, which is why influencers work so well, because they can pull some type of feeling to your brand that you can't do through pictures.
And what other things are you going to add in terms of with marketing? Because again, I think we are getting to a place where a lot of influence, we know what you're doing online now. We know you're here to make money. So if someone is going to say, this is the best cream I've ever used today, yeah. we know you're being paid to say that. So even though it still may work as a marketing tool, I think people can see through it now. So what would you suggest is like, are you using any other marketing tools that's ahead of the game?
No, we just make, so our best channel is TikTok because we're 18 to 24. So we focus a lot on TikTok and customer acquisition costs and, you know, mm-hmm. lifetime value. And we let people be real. If they want to say our leggings are rubbish, then fine, do that. But we know mm-hmm. they're not going to say that. You know, you got girls that do sweat tests and all these things. You know, be real at the end of the day. As you just said, there's so much fakeness going around online, and we want people to be real with our brand. At the end of the day, the more people are real, the more people can see. So.
And where can we get your clothing, your Able clothing?
So beable.com is where the women's fitness line is, and because of Alice, is the women's fashion.
And are you going to hope to ever have a physical shop, or you don't see the point?
No, for sure. So we're making plans for sure for beable to have physical stores, and they're not going to be like, you know, just a point to sell. They're going to be a point where people can come together, especially young people, and meet people and create content. I don't know what it's going to have in store at this moment in time. I mean, that's still...
It's going to be a hub, like a usable hub.
Exactly, it's going to be a hub. But we haven't planned that yet. That's a little bit down the line. As mm-hmm. I said, our mind's 3 years down the line, but we've still got to deal with where we are today.
Okay. Well, I ask every single person that I interview, and I think because you are so passionate about the next generation, how would you feel about taking a person on to shadow you? And I know that you're in the Midlands, so I would make it Midlands specific because, again, we go online and everything just looks so easy. Mm. But even hearing your story, working flat out, staying at home, grinding, not shagging, not drinking, not partying as much as everyone else, it takes real dedication. So would you be willing to take someone on? I can screen them in everything.
No, we get asked all the time. It just needs to be the right time and the right thing for the company. But for sure, we will have people shadow us. I mean, I've done interviews with guys online that people you'll never see. And I'll just randomly start FaceTiming someone, or someone will message me and I'll just ring them on Instagram, and like, they've got a question. I think, you know what? I'm just going to video call this guy and just speak to them. Mm. And that's really nice because you can give someone something they never thought. Sometimes they're like, he won't even reply, but then I give them some information that they can then take through their life and some perspective. I mean, at 29, I mean, I'm not saying that's old or young, but I feel like I've got a hell of a lot of life experience. I've seen all the best parts, and I've seen some of the worst parts from a business perspective. So I can give someone some great life advice.
Do you think we take things for granted in London? Because coming from the Midlands, my family are from the Midlands, they're from Leicester.
Right.
And there's not loads of opportunity. The aim is to always come down to London, but you've managed to blow in the Midlands.
Well, the internet is just, you can reach anyone in the world.
Yeah.
Anyone in the world. I mean, look at Linked Up TV. I mean, you know, you've got people from London, but there's probably people from America watching the YouTube videos every single day. Mm-hmm. So the power of the internet, you can reach the world by being any remote place you can. You need to take advantage of that.
Yeah, of course. And how do you balance your family work balance? Because you've recently had a child, is that right?
So I've recently had a little girl, which has changed my life in terms of the way I can love someone. I mean, I've got two dogs as well, and I love them unbelievably. But then when you see your little girl that you've made, and she kind of looks like you, feels like you, like someone will touch her, and it feels like they're touching me.
Yeah.
But that's a different type of love you can't ever experience until, obviously, you have kids. So, I mean, the work-life balance will change for sure because I want to spend as much time with my kids, because at the end of the day, like, there's only one chance in my life that I'm ever going to get to see her like this small. So yeah, I'll go in for meetings and whatever I need to do if mm-hmm. it's really important, of course, but I'll take time to spend time with the family and stuff.
Is your week busy? Is it literally back to back every day?
Yeah, well, it depends on the week too. I'm not going to sit here and say I get up at 5 a.m. and yeah. I go to the gym and then I watch 16 podcasts and I read books and then I go to work and I do this, because that's not how life works.
I'm glad you said that, because so many successful people go on like it's literally that. And that isn't life either. It's all well and good grinding your ass off, which I think is important. People must know that hard work and dedication has to go into anything that you do. But then, come on, you have to be realistic and also enjoy the fruits of your labour.
Absolutely. So, like, my routine is like any routine. I'll get up in the morning, but I'll do whatever it is on the day I need to do. If there's a day where I don't want to do anything at all, then I just won't do anything at all.
Yeah, like, of course.
I'm not super strict like that, but I also, as I mentioned earlier, a routine is extremely important. Extremely important.
Well, thanks for coming.
No, thank you for having me on. I appreciate it.
And hope we can think about some leggings for myself.
I'll sort you out. Yeah, let's sort you out.
Thank you.